first term that government called a hero. So thanks very much, everybody, for having me. I'm super excited to be here. It's the first time I've been at StarFest and ScaleFest, so I'm super keen to talk to all of you. And as Sarah mentioned, I'm going to be chatting a little bit about the post-seed gap, getting from your seed round to Series A round. So just to give you a little idea about me, and I don't know why I did this as a build, but I did. There we go. Just to give you a sense of kind of the type of capital I've raised. So over four companies, I've done pretty much every type of raise you could possibly imagine. So with FakeSpace, the first startup company that I did, virtual reality company, we had debt, we raised debt, we had venture capital and private equity, all three of those. RSS Solutions, the second company, it was all private equity invested. PostRank, the company Sarah mentioned that I sold to Google in 2011, we had angel capital. In fact, I was an angel investor in PostRank myself, which is how I got connected to the founder entrepreneur. And we also raised venture capital, and then Exonify, my company today, I've done all of those things, angel capital, venture capital, debt of various forms, and private equity. So I've been through not just various raises in terms of the types of capital, but also I've seen, and this has occurred over the last 15 or 17 years, so I've seen cycles in terms of, you know, economic cycles that we've gone through, and cycles in funding that have had a pretty dramatic impact on an entrepreneur's ability to raise capital effectively and quickly, and the kinds of companies that you need to be in order to raise that capital. So just a really quick poll. Is anybody looking for a Series A right now? Wow, okay, quite a few. Anybody not looking yet but planning for one? Okay, quite a few more. All right, so hopefully a few of the tips and tricks that I talk about will help you. And also, what I'm trying to do is give you a sense of the sorts of things you need to be thinking about if you are in that position of currently raising or looking to raise. So, I will start by saying this. It has actually never been easier to raise seed capital than it's faster, simpler than it's ever been. So how many of you who've raised seed capital found that it was reasonably easy to raise your seed round? Okay, not as many of you. So others found it somewhat tough? Okay, that's interesting. Well, if you look across the wide spectrum of companies in North America, in fact, it's easier than it's ever been kind of in history, and certainly in my career, to raise seed capital. But it's never been harder to move from seed to Series A, and there are a number of reasons for that I'm going to chat about. So the reason I said it's easier now than prior to raise seed capital is that the sources of seed capital are actually more voluminous than they've ever been also. So, you know, AngelList came up a few years ago. There are lots of angel groups now in cities, so if you go city by city, lots of groups you can access. Accelerators are all over the place, making introductions and connections for you. And there are, certainly where I live in Waterloo, a lot more high net worth individuals who are intrigued by the thought of investing in the next Facebook or, you know, Shopify, and are willing to invest a little bit of capital. So the types of seed stage investors have expanded, but also the numbers of them have also expanded, which has meant it is generally easier to raise some seed capital. But what that's also done is lulled all of us into a sense of false security in terms of it was easier to raise seed capital, so it's going to be just as easy to raise Series A, and that's unfortunately not the case. You get to that, and then you get your seed, and then this happens. You find this huge chasm, and it's almost like a trap that you can fall into, and it comes out of nowhere, can creep up on you really, really quickly, and then you find yourself needing to figure out how to get from point A to point B. So I said a moment ago, it's a trap. And again, just because it was easy to raise seed doesn't mean it's going to be easy to raise Series A. So here's a little bit of data that I thought was really, really interesting. Mattermark, which does a whole bunch of interesting data analysis, did a study a few years ago. And the thesis they had, they were trying to figure out how is it that companies, fewer and fewer of them are able to raise. So what is that data? And they did a study that showed between 2009 and 2012, only 31 out of 100 companies that were seed funded successfully raised a Series A. So 30% essentially, meaning 70%, which is a lot, never went on to a Series A. And when they looked at Series A to B to C all the way to F, it was pretty linear. About 50% of each of those cohorts dropped off with each successive raise. So the odds are not great when it comes to getting through each of those rounds of capital. So Series A funds, so many of you would have noticed, I mean, I see it all the time. I subscribe to, P-Hub Wire and a bunch of the investor blogs that you can, and investment type blogs that you can subscribe to. And I'm always looking at seeing who's raising funds and all of that kind of stuff. So Series A funds, particularly the last 5 years, have gotten bigger than they've ever been before. And they're writing bigger and bigger checks. And so Mattermark, again, did a little bit of analysis and found that the average Y Combinator Series A went from 2 million to 10 million from 2008 to 2014. That's a massive jump, a five-fold jump. So that alone is kind of pushing everything in a certain direction. And then Preqin, another analyst, says that the average Series A just in the first half of last year, 2016, was $12 million. Now these are US-based studies. We don't have a lot of Canadian data, unfortunately. And I would suggest that Canadian data is still slightly less than this, but certainly the trend is moving in this direction. The unfortunate thing is the number of deals closed, or the number of checks written, did not increase proportionately. So even though the size of the funds and the checks were bigger, they didn't necessarily do more deals. A typical partner will still do 1 to 3 deals a year. They just happen to be bigger checks. So what does that mean? It means that those investors are looking for the best, biggest, the things that are going to make them the hero, actually, with those big checks. Writing a check for 10 million versus 2 million means you're hoping you've got a 5 times better chance of making that successful than the $2 million company. So what they do when they're writing bigger checks for Series A is they put heavier milestones on the entrepreneurs in terms of the measures of success. And so what that means is that there are fewer startups that are moving past seed because they just can't meet those milestones. So it used to be that, a million or two could get you to 1 to 2 million in revenue, and then you were able to go on and raise a Series A that was maybe 2 to 3 and keep going. So that's kind of the old way. The old way was, and the old way, it's not that many years ago, quite frankly, and I'll tell you about Exotify in a second, but you'd raise 750, sometimes 500 to 1.5 in seed. You get some early product market fit, but not perfect, but you had the early indicators that things were going well. You hit $1 million in revenue, and then you could raise your 2 to 3 million Series A. The trend now is to raise a bigger seed, 1.5 to 2.5 million. You really have to nail your product market fit so hard, not just kind of have the early indicators of it. You got to hit 4 to 5 million in revenue and then go out to raise your $10 to $15 million Series A. So this is kind of the ship that's sailing now, particularly in the US, if you're looking for US investors. Canada is coming up behind that. And so you need to keep this in mind when you're going for your Series A, because it is no longer, you don't want to fall into that trap of only having raised $500,000 and then running out of capital and needing an additional, thinking you're going for your Series A. It's going to be really hard to go for your Series A if you're thinking in that that old way. So I can tell you when we were starting Exonify in 2011, our first round was $1.7 million. So sort of, you know, kind of in the middle of both of those things. And $1.7 million, our Series A was $3.3 million. And then we've raised collectively about another $32 million since then. So a little, I was kind of in the middle of that when we were doing that in 2011. So how do you increase your chances of success for raising a successful Series A? What I said a moment ago, think about raising a little bit more in your seed round. So going from 2 to 2.5 million, and sometimes what that means is that you leave it open for a little bit longer period of time. So if you're able to engage successfully, investors say for $1.5 million, don't necessarily close it off. If you think you've still got some good conversations going, you can keep that rolling and get upwards of $2 to $2.5 million and buy yourself more time to get the traction you need to get to a Series A. Second thing, be careful about who you have invest in that round. What you don't want are a pile of people that invested $10,000 or $15,000 each, and you've got 1 million shareholders, none of whom can invest in a Series A. You want to be certain that you've got in that group of people some that have some dry powder left to be able to re-up on your Series A and give that positive indication of interest, but also be there for you if the Series A is a little bit harder. So you also want their advice and help. Leverage government funding wherever you can. I know it goes without saying, but I can tell you with Exonify, now we're an Ontario-based company, but we've raised FedDev, we did SOFI, IRAP, SHRED, we just applied for another $250,000. And you would think that, you know, I just raised in the fall $27 million with JMI and BDC, so BDC are one of our investors. And that didn't preclude me from, I'm still going for $250,000 of grant money in the next 6 months that we can apply to sales and marketing. So never take your eye off of those opportunities. Even if it's $30,000 or $50,000, it can go a long way to paying, you know, for a particular trade show or a dev or, you know, something part-time that can help you get to that milestone. Leverage MRR funding. So the other thing that's really interesting that's happened over the last few years is Canadian financial institutions, happily, RBC being one of them that we use, are much more amenable to doing MRR-based financing. So get a line of credit the moment you can that is based on your MRR, which presumably is going to grow month over month, so give you more capacity. So even if the line is very small to begin with, get it in place, and they will fund, you know, anywhere from 70 to 80% of your contracted MRR. And that just gives you, I call that an insurance policy with the RBC base line of credit. We have a $2 million line of credit, we've never touched it. So it's still there and it's, you know, potential insurance. And it came in very, very helpful, in fact, when we were raising our last round, because we had cash in the bank, we also had the $2 million line of credit. We had $7 million of capital that allowed me to say to the investors that we were looking at, we don't need cash. We actually have the capacity and our runway is extended, and the RBC line of credit is a big component of that. Watch your spend. You know, it's pretty incredible how quickly you can spend $1 million, right? And again, that goes without saying. When you're moving from seed to Series A, be very, very careful and strategic about how you spend that money. Be laser focused on the things that you need to do to get traction, because traction is what's going to make or break your Series A. keep those seed investors informed and engaged. I can't, so one of the things I do in my spare time a lot is I will typically, at the end of the day or for breakfast, three times a week meet early stage entrepreneurs just to offer advice. I am astounded at the numbers of entrepreneurs who are coming to me with this gap, but also who say, yeah, I took $1 million a year ago or a year and a half ago from a group of angels, and I haven't talked to them since. So if you don't keep your investors informed and aware of what you're doing, they can't be out there talking to people that you want them talking to generate excitement in your business and also potentially be there for you when you go to raise that Series A. So you must, you know, even if it's a $10,000 or $25,000 investor, keep them informed and aware because they can help you. You can leverage them when you do that Series A. Understand your inflection points. This is another one that, you know, just kind of puzzles me. I find a lot of entrepreneurs who don't really understand the metrics that they need to understand to get traction, to be appealing to other, to investors. What are the things that you need to do and know? So talk to other people that are informed in your industry, potential investors, about what's important for you to be tracking and know when you go to do that Series A pitch, and work to those things. You know, there are lots of early stage entrepreneurs who are just like, well, we're growing, we're doing great things, we have the best product. I hear it over and over and over again, and you need to be laser focused on metrics. So things like CAC and LTV, which are now pretty common in the SaaS world, you just need to know those things. Because, you know, somebody said, it wasn't me, some time ago, you know, there's nothing like numbers to F up a really good story. So if you're not on the numbers and you don't understand the numbers, it doesn't matter how good your story is. So beyond that, give yourself time. Reassess a good 6 months ahead of your cash out date of what you need to do. And if you don't think you've got the amount of money you need to get you through, you might want to consider something that's cropped up the last few years, which is a post-seed grant, which we'll talk about in a second. You also have to be, if you're in that gap and you need something in between, very realistic about your valuation. Again, you know, I talk to lots of early stage folks who just don't understand really what their companies are worth. Talk to lots of people. And we all think what we're doing is the best thing ever, myself included, but you've got to kind of be realistic about that. And if you have a number of opportunities that are maybe just less than what you're looking for, but they're there and you're in that gap, you know, if you've got a bird in the hand, I'm one to say, be careful about turning that bird away because there might not be another one. So just be very careful about valuation. And don't try for a Series A too early. If you haven't hit those milestones, if you don't have the traction, if you don't have what your target investors are looking for, and you go out too early, you're going to blow your brains out, get turned down a million times, and you're going to get tainted. People like fresh new stories. Behind you, there are 100 other people coming in the door to pitch fresh new stuff. And what you don't want to do is have to cycle back 6 or 8 months later and redo the same story with a little bit of progress because they turned you down the first time. That's kind of not a good thing to do. All right, I'm going to just touch really briefly on this. This idea of a post-seed round, sometimes it's called now a seed extension round. And so this is what we're seeing is kind of coming out to help bridge that gap. And so there are certain investors kind of coming out of the woodwork to help fill this gap. So this was an article written by Paul Martino from Bullpen Capital. It's a really good article, and he had a table in that article that talked about post-seed round is not a bridge. So a lot of early stage entrepreneurs go to investors saying, I need a bridge. Go to new investors, net new investors saying, I need a bridge. That is just the wrong thing to say. A bridge connotes things aren't going so well. and you need a little bit of extra to help, going to a net new investor with a bridge story is never a good idea. So he had this really good table to help you decide where are you at and how do you position yourself if you find yourself in this gap. Bottom line is this, if you are looking for a bridge, you've got less than 6 months of runway and you need that little bit of extra, you are likely going back to your existing investors to get that money. And you need to be, as I said earlier, hyper focused on what you're going to accomplish in that 6 months before you go out. A post-seed round sometimes is actually flat to your seed round or just a little bit higher valuation. But a post-seed round is a better story. So you've got more runway when you go out to do it. You're looking to de-risk certain things, not just, you know, as he says here in the poker analogy, I'm a poker player, so I love poker analogies. Instead of just sort of flipping the next card to see, you know, something good happens, you're actually pushing all in because you've got really good early indications and you're looking to double down on something and you need that extra capital before you do the big Series A. Your ability to attract investors, you know, as you said in the last line of the table, with a bridge, net new investors with a bridge is low, with, you know, post-seed is pretty moderate. So think about it that way. And I think I'm over time here, so I'm going to whip through the rest of this. Okay, this is the last slide. When you're ready, pitch, 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 pitch. I'm invested in or was invested in a company. The entrepreneur went out, blew his brains out, trying to raise a Series A, and refused, kept delaying, deferring, pitching his investors, his current investors. And when we finally did see the pitch after he met with five private equity firms and big names that were all very interested in the beginning, and then we saw his pitch, it was horrible. Like, I can't even say how horrible it was. It was horrible. And that guy ended up not being able to raise capital because he poisoned the well, frankly. And we ended up selling the company for not very much money, to be honest, because he ran out of capital. So also, we realize, number two, it's easier to grow the size of a round than shrink it. So when you go in, make sure that you're if you're thinking like 10 to 12, start off by saying I'm raising 7 to 10. If they really like the story, you will always have the opportunity to grow it. But it's very hard to go in and say I need 15 and then, you know, ratchet it back to 7 and 8 when you kind of sense that that's what people are willing to do. And take a hint. If you don't get early interest, do not overshop it. Go back, retool, think about how you're going to reposition yourselves, and then go forward again. Don't just keep beating the same drum over and over and over again, because while you're doing that, you're running out of money. Good luck.